view them, and we don't know all the facts, and we probably never will, and tell a story that was sort of infuriating, because at the end, you know, it sort of provokes more questions than it does good answers.
And the actor playing Senator Kennedy, Jason Clark.
Sorry, what? I didn't hear
oh, the actor. Your actors, you know, Jason Clark, who plays Senator Kennedy. You just said backstage you've actually known him for a long time. How did the two of you work together to, you know, come up with this portrait of the senator?
Jason had done a lot of work before I met him. He had a lot of ideas before I met him. He was attached to it when I took it on. And he didn't want to do a caricature. He wanted to do something that was empathetic. But he also didn't want to pull any punches. He wanted to be very hard-hitting and be honest. But, you know, you could study this story forever. I've read most of the books that are written on it, and I've read a lot from all the people involved. And, you know, it's absolutely a tragedy that turned into a farce, and I think that's the tone of film that we try to make.
I mean, even to the extent you had a couple of actors who are best known as comedians, Ed Helms, Jim Gaffigan.
Exactly, yeah.
Also in the cast, the casting of Mary Jo. Uh-huh. You got Kate Mara. What was the decision, you know, getting someone who we would recognize and almost expect to have a larger role in the film for that pivotal but, you know, smaller role?
We changed the script somewhat, that we had flashbacks in the structure that maybe brought her back in the end of the film, but she was always going to be a character that didn't survive, you know. Halfway through the story, I couldn't change that. So, I mean, every actor's taken it on, understood that.
What about the audience? Anyone questions in the audience? There's one right there.
Did this have to wait for Kennedy's death, and did you get any kind of feedback from the family whatsoever on their position?
Could people in the back hear the question?
He wants to know if... it's all done.
We can share. He was asking if this had to wait until, you know, the Kennedys, after the Kennedys' death, if you had any feedback or response from the family.
No, I mean, we didn't get any feedback from the family. I didn't expect to. We didn't reach out to them, obviously. I think that, you know, Teddy died in 2008, I believe. So he's been, it's well after he passed away. And, you know, I shot this, some of the scenes were shot on Chappaquiddick on the actual bridge, because the actual bridge there, and when the little kid runs to that house, that's the house, that's how far away an actual house was from the bridge that Teddy walked past. And even the people on Chappaquiddick, we thought we'd get a lot of pushback from them, but they sort of fully embraced us shooting there and very helpful. And it's such ancient history to them that I don't really think it had, you know, I think if I had tried to do this 15 years ago, it might have been an issue when Teddy was alive, but not now.
Did you hear anything from the locals that actually became part of the film?
Not really. I mean, everybody has this. I mean, I ran into a lady when I was shooting, and she said, oh, my father is Chief Arena. And she gave me his phone number, you know, the chief there, and I called him, and he's very old now, you know, he's well into his 80s, and the stuff that he remembers is kind of all the stuff that you read about, you know what I mean? It's almost his memories become muddled with, I think, a lot of fables and myths that have kind of, you know, built up over the years, and so, no, I mean, we didn't really get anything. The touchstone for the writers, and for me, was the inquest. About a month and a half after the court date that Teddy had, it's in the film, you know, because of public outrage, there was an inquest that was driven by the DA, and it was another softball kind of investigation, but, you know, they interviewed every single person involved in that night, all the boardroom girls and the lawyers. And it wasn't, we used that as a template for the film, and it wasn't any more revealing than that. I mean, they had gotten the story straight by then, so it wasn't any more revealing.
Another audience question, ma'am, right there?
At some level, I sort of see the film as a study in myth-making. I mean, were you interested in that aspect?
That's, yes, very much so. I think it's sort of a myth becoming history, you know? I mean, what I loved about the script, that it sort of charted the ever-evolving story, almost like a Rashomon kind of experience, and, you know, the story was one thing, then it became another, then it became another, and we felt that by kind of showing all the versions, you know, in the end, like I said, I wasn't trying to, like, blow the lid off the truth on this. I think that's impossible unless you're one of the handful of people that are still alive that were part of that night. But certainly, I think it's very interesting to see the evolution of a story that now has become kind of fact. You know, so I don't consider the film like I consider it more of a fable than the truth.
So what's the myth and what's the fact?
I don't know. I mean, I don't. I actually have no idea what happened that night. I mean, I had my own ideas. You know, you read enough, and you're pretty sure it was a drunken accident, and that because of the state he was in. And look, I've been out there at like 11:30 at night with Jason, who plays Teddy, and there's no ambient light on that bridge. It is black as black can be. And it's a tidal pond, so there's a very strong current running under the bridge. It's very possible that he was drunk, and it's black. You don't know what's up and what's down, and you can't even swim, and you can't get to the car because it's possible he just gave up. He tried and gave up. Who knows? You know what I mean? But I don't think we're ever going to know. And I really want to kind of just create false narratives. I want to try to stick to what we kind of were corroborated facts, and then fill in the rest of our imagination.
Another question? I don't want to ignore the people in the back. Very last row in the center. Yes?
What can you do
for
the right person to tell
the
story?
Oh, God, I don't know. A lucky fluke. I mean, Jason, a lot of actors chased this or didn't chase it. And Jason, from the beginning, was adamant that he wanted to play Teddy Kennedy. Which I think was awesome when I heard the idea of it, because it's very difficult to divorce yourself from, if you have a really well-known actor in that role, you know, Tom Cruise or Christian Bale, someone that, it's hard to kind of accept that's Teddy Kennedy. It's like, oh, there's that guy playing somebody. And Jason's kind of not that well-known. It was perfect, and as a director, for me, it was fantastic, because I didn't have to fight against all the, you know, preconceptions about that actor. I got it because I know Jason and I know his manager, and we all wanted to work together again, so I was in the right place at the right time. But I mean, you know, I don't know if I was exactly, who knows, you know? I'll say that I was.
And a fine director in your life. Tracks in the way that we don't hear anymore. How about right in front now?
Yes, I noticed on the credits that the movie was filmed in both Massachusetts and Mexico. Wouldn't it have been expensive to go all the way to Mexico, and he could have gone as close as Long Island to film the shore scenes?
You got a big tank in Long Island where I could film?
Oh, we needed a tank?
Oh, yeah.
So that's...
You know that tank that James Cameron built for Titanic?
Oh, so in other words, the tank with the car...
Yeah, it's a very big, controlled tank, meaning that you've got actually five tanks to work in, it's... You can control the current, you can control the temperature. You know, you've got actors that have to work in there at night.
Oh.
And in the fall in Long Island,
so when you show Ted Kennedy swimming around trying to free Mary Jo Kopechne, that's all conjecture.
Say that again?
When you show Ted trying to get the car open underwater, so that's all conjecture?
Is it conjecture that he tried to save her?
Yes.
He says that he did, so I showed it, but I also showed the possibility that he didn't, because I don't know.
Oh, okay.
And neither do you.
Time for a few more questions. Over there.
What was the chronic role in the family at that time? Why was he there of the PR campaign?
Question about the presence of Robert McNamara at that time, what his role was with the Kennedys.
I mean, you know, in 68, when... It's pretty likely that Bobby would have gotten the Democratic nominee. When he got shot, when he died, the entire party aligned behind Ted. They were going to hand him the nomination. And the country wanted Ted to run. They started this draft Ted kind of movement. And Ted was a mess. I mean, his two brothers had been killed. He was drinking. You know, he was an absolute mess. You can understand. You know, he was the last brother. All of his brothers have been killed in the line of duty. And, but there was the assumption that in 72 he was a shoo-in, you know? The war wasn't going well, people hated Nixon. And in 69 he was as likely a candidate to get the presidency as anyone. you know, as anybody. And all those guys, Sorensen, McNamara, they've all been part of the Kennedy machinery for a whole decade. They came there to protect not only his legacy, but theirs. That's why they're there.
A couple more questions. Oh, anyway, I'm going to this side.
There's no evidence that he was having an affair with her. There's all suspicion. I mean, there was six unmarried women with five married guys without their wives, and then there was one bachelor, the old guy that another girl was going to be with them with. So it doesn't look good, okay? But there's, when you read about Mary Jo, and by all accounts and the people that knew her, she doesn't seem like that type, but again, who knows? You know, I'm reading what could be PR, you know? And I don't want to point any punches and say that they didn't, but I certainly don't want to say that they did, because there's absolutely no evidence at all that they had any physical relationship, and it's been denied by everybody involved in that story. Does it look bad? Yeah. But, you know, it's that kind of story where, you know, what's infuriating is what you don't know and what we probably never know.
One last question. I'll go to Sarah in the back there.
You made much of the character, Joe Gargan, setting up kind of as a moral compass for Teddy. You know, he always serviced him and all sorts of favors for him before. And then at the end,
there's a Senatorial Privilege is a book that's probably the best of the books on this subject, and he did contribute to that book, but a lot of that book takes his words from the inquest. You know, he was adopted. He was like a fixer for Teddy, you know, an advanced man kind of guy who'd go and rent hotel rooms, but he's also a lawyer in his own right, very, very smart guy. He did get thrown under the bus during this episode. I think him and Markham, the Brain Trust guys, McNamara and Sorensen and those guys, they were livid with Joey for letting Teddy get into this mess. They blamed Joey as much as they blamed Ted. And I think, you know, Joey hung around as a friend and family until the 72, you know, election, and then he sort of drifted away. You know, to get some distance, and ultimately became, you know, pretty estranged from the Kennedys, and that's just we didn't talk to him, we didn't reach out to him, but it's a pretty well-known fact that he sort of disconnected from the Kennedys after that.
All right, I'm gonna go one last question. He's standing up. Go for it.
Do you think what is it like working with the Massachusetts accent? I know that can really easily dip into like parody territory almost. So, but I love how Jason Clark was able to kind of, you know, he did it sparingly and subtly. And there was even the difference when he turned it on during his televised speech. It almost seemed more accented. Like, so what is it like trying to get a good authentic Massachusetts accent on screen?
Well, first you get a really good dialect coach, which is what we had. Someone that's worked with Jason for years. His name is Tim Monarch, who's probably the best in the business. We got him, which we're very lucky, and he worked with Jason for months. And Jason had done a series in Rhode Island, so he had like an idea of the regional dialect, but for Ted, he didn't want to do a character like Mary Quimby on The Simpsons or something. You know, we were all aware that it could be caricature. But the other thing I did is I was adamant that, you know, films these days, you shoot anywhere where there's an incentive, which is really annoying. But I wanted to shoot in Massachusetts. I wanted to shoot on tape, you know, because I knew that 80% of our cast was going to be local and a lot of non-actors. And I figured if I could surround the main cast with real Boston accents, that it would just lift the whole film, and it wouldn't be... The worst would be if you had semi-actors doing Boston accents. That's when you really noticed it. You know, so I didn't want to shoot like in Toronto or some other city that was going to, you know, to stand in for Boston. That would be interesting.
Well, John, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.